How are you doing, Erin?
I'm doing well, Marcia. How are you?
Pretty good. So we're
Good.
going to do a very what's usually an informal interview, but we really
Yep.
want to hear from you because you're wanting to be reappointed to HARB.
That's right.
So the first question is, why are you wanting to continue with HARB?
Why? Maybe the question is why not?
Well, yeah, that could
Well,
be too. Yeah, let's frame it in a positive way.
Well, my husband and I have lived in the city for quite some time, probably 20, I'm guessing, I think probably about 25 years. And it's just a community that I want to continue to support. I've always loved historic buildings and all the history and architecture that are associated with that. We have so many great resources in our city, and it just seemed like a really great fit for me to do that. So, this is going to be my third term. So I've been on the board for 10 years. And have just, I've seen it change a lot. I've seen the city change, populations change, but want to continue to support that in as much as I can. And that's where I'd like to put my time.
Great. And I'm going to turn it over to my fellow council members. We have Johanny Cepeda Freitas here and also Wes Butler. So,
Great.
Johanny?
Well, Erin, hi, and
Hi.
welcome. Thank you
Thank
for
you.
your service, dedication, and wanting to go for your for a reappointment.
Thank you.
What are some of the more difficult issues HARB has encountered, and what did you and the board do to try to resolve these issues?
Okay. Well, I was kind of ready for that question. If you don't mind, I'm going to kind of put it more into present tense because I think these are the kind of things that we just continue to kind of work through. We've been a fairly small board for quite some time, and I know we did reduce the requirements of the board, I think, from 11 to 9. Just fact check me, Amy, if I've done anything wrong there. Yep. And so the board has to, we're a volunteer board. We have to wear a lot of hats, but I think actually one of the biggest things is just making sure that we're trying to be as consistent as we can, like with our committees. We've got policy committees. I'm part of the education committee, which can be really challenging to try to like find the time and get the strategy developed for all of that. And populations change, audience change. So I think it's making sure that our message stays consistent. That's been, I think, just really an ongoing challenge that we have. And I'm not saying that we've overcome it, but I think as a board, we try to really put as much work and time into trying to at least keep those extra, efforts and initiatives as alive as possible. We put a lot of work into the city website a couple of years ago, and also our policy committee had helped develop a financial hardship policy too. So I think it just continues to be kind of ongoing as our board is small, and we continue to try to make sure that our policies are up to date, that the board stays educated, and we try to get some community engagement as well. That's part one. Part two is we have a pretty significant backlog on our violations. It's nobody's fault. It's just kind of the nature of how things are. I think COVID probably accelerated a lot of that as folks looked at their home and the investment in their home and wanted to make some changes and updates to that. And I think, as we look at how we manage what our current violation list is, in addition to a backlog that I know Amy kind of continues to add to. She goes out, we go out on site visits, and there's just kind of a world of issues and situations that we see that kind of go along with that. So I think it's trying to find an effective way to try to get up to date on what our violations are, and then trying to find a way that we can manage that. So I'm not saying that we've conquered that or overcome that, but I think we've got a plan in place with the help of our current board chair, Nigel Walker. I think we're going to put a little more tactical sort of steps to trying to get some control over that by visiting properties, getting an update on where all of our what the latest status is on properties, and then beginning to put a little bit more teeth to our violation and citing process.
So, other than what you've mentioned, what other recommendations do you have for this body to help deal with the backlog?
Well, I'm actually not really sure what we can do, but it does oftentimes come back to like just the resources that we have to be able to help. I mean, I think you'll find that our board, puts a, really gives a lot of time, to the board and to the effort that HARB does. We're limited in what we can do. We're also limited in our ability to enforce those other than through like the formal process of, reviewing applications, trying to understand, what kind of corrections and how to communicate that to our, to our applicants. But in many ways, it really is like trying to find and staff the office in a way that is better than it's been in the past. I know when I came before City Council, I'm going to think maybe 2 years ago, it might have been right before the pandemic. Johanna, you had some very like specific questions about that. And I had worked with Dave Paris and with Amy to develop a job description. And fortunately, it didn't get into the budget last year. But I'm optimistic that maybe now that we're out of Act 47, there might be some potential for that. I realize we can look back and say, oh, there's all these reasons why things happened. I don't want to necessarily look back. I just want to kind of look at present day, understand what we may need to support the office, even if it's an additional person or it's someone else that can help with some enforcement. The issue becomes like when there's a violation, we've had meetings that are all violations. They're not new applications for someone coming to want to do some work. We're addressing violations. It's really kind of understanding, you know, what those next step are and be able to put some like real-time efforts, some timely efforts, not just like a couple of months down the road or, you know, when staff might have time to do that. I think it's just really important to make sure that we look at enforcement. That was a big part of what this job description was including, the one that we wasn't able to get into the budget. And I think it's really important to make sure that we look at city staff to make sure that office is supported properly.
And I think you say that at a very good time because obviously we're getting ready to go into the budget.
Yep, absolutely.
And I've also seen, as I've spoken to property owners that own properties in the historic district, their frustration with getting violations, but also trying to get permits. There's a delay all around, according to what I understand, because obviously we know that Amy is one person. And over our department is overworked. I have spoken about this in the past. So you have property owners who are like very frustrated. I know one in particular who said waiting, I think, 9 months to get a permit to paint, but yet still getting violations for peeling paint. And he's like, ah, how do I make this work? But anyway, he figured it out. My point is that's one of who knows how many, right, that might be trying to deal with their violations, but might be waiting for permitting. To maybe tackle, I don't know.
Yeah, I'm not aware of a situation where someone's had to wait that degree of time. But certainly when we see violations, Amy notifies the property owner in as timely a way that she can. And we always ask them to come back before the board. We'll review their application. Sometimes we'll approve it or we'll offer some suggestions for improvement or a total correction if need be. But I want to make sure the board is viewed as a resource to help, not a bureaucratic body that kind of gets in the way. I realize it's a very personal issue when you're legislating what can actually be done to personal property of yours, but the historic district ordinance gives us that authority to do so. And I think sometimes at a fundamental level, maybe the average property owner may not fully understand where our authority may come from. And it is, it's a check, bureaucratic check that needs to happen, but we're really tasked with making sure that we're protecting the historic resource that we have. But in addition, also making sure that we're open and we're welcoming and we're collaborative with the property owner in as much as our policies and our standards that we use to interpret our decisions allow us to be.
Johanna had another question.
Should I let Wes go and then I'll come back?
Okay, yeah, Wes, do you have anything?
Yeah, since I'm new here, I never heard of HARB. So I was going to ask her if she could just give me a breakdown of what they do on the board. It doesn't have to be too long, just the main issues you guys deal with.
And I apologize. I should have actually said what HARB meant rather than just giving the initials. So go on, Aaron.
Yeah. So the HARB is, we're a citizen volunteer board, and we have the authority through the Historic District Ordinance Chapter 295 that allows us to, hang on, something just popped up there, that we as a body have to approve all the exterior alterations that are visible from a public right-of-way in the four historic districts, and then there's less requirements for the conservation district, the Heights Conservation District, which is where I live. Those are like more structural things or additions or or demolitions on properties. But basically anything that impacts any property, it can be from paint. Now, Amy does approve paint colors, but you know, whether it's something that they want to change a material or change a feature or removal of something or replacement of something, even something as simple as a light fixture, the board has to approve and guide the property owner into an appropriate choice for the style, the architecture, and the age of the building. And so we do that, we meet monthly, and we do that through application process, and our vote allows Amy to issue a certificate of appropriateness back to the property owner, which outlines in great detail what the board has voted on and is permitting the property owner to do.
Okay. I got a better understanding now. Yeah.
But many communities, let's say like Boston, you ever been to Cape May, New Jersey, it's either a historical architecture review board, it might be like a historic commission. Oftentimes they're very similar though in terms of what their purpose is. Sometimes their authority may be a little bit different, but we really have final authority. A property owner can always appeal a decision if they need to, but we have the authority to basically make a binding decision about the property.
Okay, thank you. That was my only question.
Great, okay. Good to get to know it. Yep.
Did you have another question? Wes, at some point it might be important if you can connect with Amy, just because what HARB does is really mandated by federal law, so that as we have all these historic districts in Reading, all these federal laws apply. So that's how they make their decisions. It's a very interesting process. Mm-hmm. So I think Amy would probably give you some insight.
I was going to offer that anytime you want to talk to me, mm-hmm. or you want to set up a meeting, I'd be happy to discuss the HARB and all things historic preservation with you.
So carve out a day or two, Wes, if you need
time. Yeah. Yeah, it's not a 5-minute conversation.
Okay, we'll connect.
Right, and Jeron had a follow-up then.
Yes. So Aaron, in the approximately 10 years that you've been serving, what is the most common violation? What is the most common thing that you've come across that could easily maybe be resolved?
Well, I'm not sure about the easily, but could be resolved. Well, I think it kind of sometimes comes and goes with trends or with neighborhoods. I think what we, without getting too specific, although I will, I think what we find sometimes are there are neighborhoods or streets or blocks that may have a particular alteration done that wasn't approved. It could very well have been done even before the district was, was brought in as a historic district or designated as a historic district. And so what happens is I call it kind of like this disease kind of like moves down the block, and sometimes it's really challenging. Maybe it's a door that's changed, maybe it's windows. Windows are not uncommon for a change out of materials. We understand there's, old windows can be challenging to keep painted, to keep maintained, to keep airtight as possible. But there's a lot of study and a lot of information out there that if we're able to speak to the homeowner, we can actually, talk through the benefit of keeping some of those historic features or materials. Sometimes it's just the removal of original materials or details. Maybe they become rotted. It could be a porch. We oftentimes see issues with porches, porch steps, those kind of materials. And so a homeowner believes that, I'm improving my property by adding tile or adding a material that maybe is impervious to to weather or to termite damage or something like that. And, it may be something that appears to be pretty innocuous, but can be problematic if it fundamentally, changes the appearance of the property, or in so doing removes some historic details or materials. So I would say windows, doors, that's not uncommon. And certainly porches oftentimes get removed, like columns will get removed and just replaced with like a steel post or something metal that that doesn't have the same deterioration speed, we'll say. That's some other things.
So in an ideal situation, what would be the best way to engage, to efficiently engage community and educate?
Well, I think it is important to get into the community. I would say that probably as a HARB, we haven't done a really consistent job with that. But I don't think it's it's purely just the HARB that's going to be able to communicate that. I think it's important that we connect as well with like with our council people, even as we look at like we've got, I just wrote it down, we've got both, we've got Prince, Callow Hill, and Penn's Commons. I think those are, Amy, correct me if I'm wrong, I think those are the three districts that we do not have any HARB representation from. Is that correct?
I think so, yes.
So that's three out of the four historic districts. I think it would be fantastic if we could work more closely with council, maybe with council, with a council person in those particular districts, trying to find an individual that they don't have to necessarily come fully, let's say, educated about this. The board has a very specific way in which we work, but a lot of us, you know, we really learn through the process, materials and techniques and architectural styles. But we just need someone who's really willing to make that kind of commitment and really sees the value of what historic preservation brings to their property, their block, their city, their community.
Thank you, Erin.
Absolutely. Yep.
Do you have any questions for us at all, Erin?
I would just leave you with the same challenge that I talked about before, which is, you know, really trying to find a way to prioritize, you know, better staffing in the Historic Preservation Office. Right. And maybe it's not just, okay, we just add a body and then we just do more work. Maybe it really is looking at how that work is, you know, is structured and how these positions will really help to engage. Like I said, we've got a serious violation issue. That would obviously be the first thing that would have to be worked through after the board has been through all of understand what the status of our current violations are. But I think it's, you know, just really looking at making sure that we've got some, you know, we've got tactical parts of being able to like get through that, but maybe there is also some level of community engagement with that as well, and education in conjunction with what the board is able to do.
Yeah, and thank you very much. I think this has been a good learning experience for us. Obviously we have some timely issues that involve HARB. So it is good that at least people are aware that we have historic districts in Reading and there's certain guidelines, even though they become difficult, they are still there. So
they're there for a reason. Right, exactly. And thanks to council for, you know, supporting us and as much as, you know, you're able to do, and we, you know, we look forward to you know, to even more of that and better engagement as we go forward.
Great. And so our process is we'll bring your name before council at our next meeting, which is on the 12th, for your reappointment.
Okay, very good.
And thank you for your service, Erin. Appreciate you. Appreciate the work that you do.
Okay, appreciate the opportunity. Thank you.
Have a good night.
All right, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
And so, Erin, how you doing?
Good evening. How are you? Yes, I'm doing well.
Okay, so I think you've been sitting in on the interview, so you know that it's myself, Johanny, and Wes Butler from council that will be doing the interviewing, and we'll be just sharing a very informal process. This is for a reappointment, so starting out with my question is why you're interested in staying on board with HARB.
Well, as you probably know, I've lived in the city for about 20 years now. And my wife and I both have had a long-term interest in contributing to the betterment of the city, and particularly for me as a registered architect, the betterment of the built condition within the city. Reading's unique in that it has numerous historic districts, sizable historic districts, and you know, we want to see those historical resources preserved. So I think from my perspective, what I can offer to the board and to the city at large is some experience in preservation types of construction projects and design projects, and you know, kind of offer guidance to the board as they're making decisions on how best to go about administrating the requirements of Chapter 295.
Yeah, and we thank you for your time and your expertise that you bring to the board. So I'm going to turn it over to Johanny and then to Wes for additional questions.
Okay.
So I'm going to ask you the same question I asked Erin. And what are some of the more difficult issues HARB has encountered, and what did you and the board do to try to resolve the issues?
That's a great question. I think Reading's unique in that such a high percentage of our population deals with financial disadvantage. And one of the things that we've tried to address as a board is financial hardship. I attended a conference back around 2014 and was struck by the fact that a number of HARBs from other cities around the nation did not experience the same level of financial hardship that we experienced. And so set out on a course of trying to figure out how do we address this issue on a consistent basis, rather than leaving it up to subjective opinions with each